Before proceeding, please make sure to subscribe and turn on the bell icon for upcoming videos.
The term mucocele was derived from a Latin word. Muco stands for mucus, and cele means a cavity. Therefore, mucocele is defined as a mucus-filled cyst that may appear in the oral cavity. It's the 17th most common salivary gland lesion of the oral cavity. Mucoceles are of two types, which are the mucus extravasation phenomenon, also called mucus escape reaction, and mucus retention cyst, also called salivary duct cyst or sialocyst. Now this seems to be confusing. Let's draw a diagram and differentiate between the two. The mucus extravasation phenomenon or mucus escape reaction are associated with minor salivary glands and are formed secondary to rupture of excretory duct of a gland. This rupture of the salivary duct leads to consequent spillage of saliva from the duct into the connective tissue around the gland. The mucus becomes walled off and causes a cyst-like swelling but is not lined by an epithelium. That's why they are called pseudocysts or false cysts. The spillage of mucus in extraossation phenomenon may result from local trauma to the salivary gland ducts, although in many cases there may be no known history of trauma. On the other hand, mucus retention cysts are formed secondary to obstruction of the duct, which leads to accumulation of saliva either within the gland or within its duct. Prolonged obstructions within these glands or ducts causes further fluid accumulation and results in swelling. This salivary obstruction leading to development of a cyst might result from calculus formation, scarring, and obstruction from mucin plugs. Unlike mucus extraossation phenomenon, mucus retention cyst is a true cyst, meaning that it's lined up by a layer of salivary epithelium. Let's now talk about some clinical features of both of them. Both extraossation and retention types appear as dome-shaped fluctuant mucosal swellings ranging between 1 to 2 mm to several centimeters in size. By fluctuant, it means the lesion is movable. In extraossation type, since trauma is the main cause, that's why it most often affects minor salivary glands of children. And this is because children are more prone to trauma. However, mucus retention cysts, on the other hand, are more common among adults and affects most often minor and less often major salivary glands. In case of symptoms, the extravasation type is usually symptomless or asymptomatic, but the retention type is accompanied by pain, especially during mealtimes. Because in mealtimes, saliva is stimulated the most. And as saliva cannot move beyond the obstructed zone, this results in high back pressure produced by the saliva, causing extreme pain. In cases of prolonged obstructions, a good medium for bacterial growth is always there. And this leads to an inflammation which results in expression of pus from the ductal orifice. In about 60% of cases, the site most commonly involved in extraossation type is the lower lip. And lesions in the lower lip are usually found lateral to the midline. The most common site in mucus retention cyst is the floor of the mouth, the buccal mucosa, and the lips. A well-known characteristic variant of the extravasation type is the superficial mucocele. These superficial mucocels, as their name suggests, presents as single or multiple hard vesicles measuring between 1 to 4 mm in diameter. It can develop in some rare sites like buccal mucosa and retromolar pad region. Their vesicular appearance is created by superficial nature of the mucin spillage, which causes a separation of the epithelium from the underlying connective tissue. Within a matter of days, the lesion bursts on its own, leaving behind shallow and painful ulcers that heals by themselves. This superficial variant most often appears in association with lichenoid disorders, such as lichen planus, lichenoid drug eruptions, and chronic graft versus host disease. Let's now talk about some histologic features for both types of mucocels. The extravasation phenomenon shows area of spilled mucin surrounded by compressed connective tissue wall or a granulation tissue. The adjacent connective tissue shows numerous inflammatory cells like macrophages, neutrophils, eosinophils, and lymphocytes. In addition, a feeding duct from an adjacent salivary gland might be seen draining within the mucin-filled cavity. On the other hand, in mucus retention cysts, the cystic lining appears to be variable and may consist of cuboidal, columnar, or atrophic squamous epithelium, surrounding a small cystic cavity that contains thick mucoid secretions at its center. The epithelium often demonstrates papillary folds that projects into the cystic lumen. The mucus retention cysts are best treated by conservative measures, like by prescribing analgesics, antibiotics if associated with inflammations, mouthwashes, and sialogogues. If the lesion does not dissolve with these measures, then the only option we have is their surgical excision. On the other hand, the extravasation type are usually short-lived lesions. They rupture and heal in a period between 3 to 6 weeks on its own. In some cases, the lesion may enter a chronic phase where local surgical excision becomes necessary. Since this type has the tendency towards recurrence, that's why removal of adjacent minor salivary gland becomes necessary, especially in the cases where the adjacent gland appears to be feeding into the lesion when the area is excised. The excised tissue should be submitted for macroscopic examination to confirm the diagnosis and rule out the possibility of a salivary gland tumor.
If you think this video was really helpful, please do like the video and subscribe the channel. If you have got any questions or suggestions, you may write them down in the comment box. Thank you for watching.